Hello, boys and girls. You are now listening, if you're on Stitcher, SoundCloud, and or iTunes, and watching if you're on YouTube, Peter and Jake Talks Wrasslin. Boot 'em ups in the trunk. Turn the bass up.
What's up?
Hello.
And if you notice, we have a, and if you're watching, we have a third visitor today. Tell the people what your name is.
My name is Luke Williams.
Yes, this is Peter, Jake, and Luke Talks Wrasslin this episode. It's a little snug in this motherfucker, as you can see. Actually, I'm going to make a quick adjustment to the video.
Okay.
All right, word up.
Just a slide real quick so we can all...
Okay. Well, Luke, how long have you been a wrestling fan? And, like, tell us a little bit about yourself, man.
I've been a wrestling...
Speak up there, Billy D. Williams.
I've been a wrestling fan since I was a little kid. I had the LJN figures.
Nice.
Grew up watching it. And then I kind of fell out of it during college.
Yeah.
And I don't really feel like I missed too much. But I've been back into it for the past couple years. So
that's awesome. So, like, what time did you, like, get back into it?
Probably 2012, 2013, nice. Somewhere in that range.
Oh, yeah. That's cool. What do you say, like, got you into it? Like, maybe, like, Punk or Brian or Cena?
Bored, probably.
just honestly, what started it was buying old figures from when I was a kid. And it kind of, I was like, well, I'll check it out. I'll see what's new. And then I got stuck.
What WrestleMania What WrestleMania was that?
30.
WrestleMania 30.
Jake the Snake was inducted that year, I believe. Oh, he's a big favorite of mine.
That's awesome. That's,
yeah, because I got back into it when it was 28, WrestleMania 28. That was Shawn Michaels versus Undertaker, the first one. I guess the first of the two at the end. Because how many times have they faced?
Undertaker and Shawn at WrestleMania, like...
I know, 28 and 29.
I think that's it. Well, there might be another one, but I think that's it at WrestleMania. I know they wrestled at Royal Rumble... I'm going to say, what is it? I think Royal Rumble 97. They wrestled,
okay.
And then they also wrestled a few other times.
Yeah. But at WrestleMania, that's when I got back into it.
Oh, and they also wrestled the first Hell in a Cell match. They wrestled, countless.
So, now that we got him out of the way, and like, what the fuck? Because he showed up late. He's would have brought like a third person, a second person. So we've actually been sitting on our hands. And, you know, I'm just going to rib him right now for it. Like,
fair enough.
If you ever do this shit again, we're going to lay the smack down. We're going to be like, don't fuck up. Don't fuck up. And we're going to switch it around.
I will say that we were supposed to meet at 5 originally, and you said
5:30. I said 5:30.
No, you said 5:45.
I said I'll probably work at 4.
It's cool.
And I got an hour and a half of watch. So, yeah. I told you. If I would have told you anything different, I would have sent you a text. Don't make this shit about me, man. The fuck? He's just showing up. He's trying to show me up on my own fucking shit right now. It's fucked up. Take a breath. All right, I'll take a breath. So, Raw, Memphis, right?
Oh, yeah.
Raw, Memphis. Before that, did any of y'all guys listen to the Jake the Snake interview with Stone Cold Steve Austin?
I did not. I saw it was up, and I've listened to an interview that he did recently with John Pollock.
That's the one I heard.
Yeah. That's the one you heard? I can't say. I know that one with Stone Cold is probably the interview of the year.
Yeah?
It's probably, because it's like, it's one thing to talk to Pollock. Pollock knows his stuff. But he ain't no old school worker like,
yeah.
Like Stone Cold is. And I swear to God, listening to those two go back and forth was like the greatest thing I've ever heard. I have never heard it, other than, say, his interview with Vampiro, another excellent. If you haven't listened to that yet.
Yeah, I've heard that one. That one's pretty good.
Oh, man, it's excellent. This one takes the cake. This one is probably the greatest interview I've ever heard. And it runs for like an hour, 25 minutes. It's like I'm going to listen to it again, like, as I set this shit up. I mean, we'll break all this stuff down and set it up.
Well, hi, bam.
Yeah. Anything on the wrestling front that you check out? Like, we were supposed to be watching PWG
Battle of Los Angeles.
Yes.
I gotta get my hands on that this weekend. It's quite a hefty purchase, $70 for wrestling DVDs. So, like,
three of them, huh?
Three of them. But I get them every year. I've had the past 3 years, so I'm gonna get this one. But I mean, it just takes a few weeks to accumulate.
Mike just had a you know.
But then you don't got like the pack. It's cool, man. The pack.
Anything on the NXT cool. front? What's going on in there?
I heard ZZ signed a contract.
ZZ
from Tough Enough.
Oh yeah.
You don't watch Tough Enough?
I don't.
I ain't watched that show.
Okay, I watched Tough Enough.
Okay.
I watched the whole season. Tough Enough.
And ZZ, I know ZZ was like ZZ the big was alligator
guy.
Yeah.
I heard that he signed a developmental deal and is already it.
He won't make it.
Another person who that wrestled on the Battle of Los Angeles that signed a deal is Rich Swann, which is amazing. He's like a big indie star, if you don't know who he is. Wrestles in Dragon Gate. He's part of the Inner City Machine Guns with Ricochet.
What does he look like?
Tiny little black guy, does a lot of flips.
Oh. I've never seen him. I mean, I only know the only dude I know is ACH.
He's the only person who can do a standing 450. He can do a variation of a second row maneuver that no one else in the world can do, and he comes out singing Lionel Richie all night long.
That's a win.
Where could I see him? Just Dragon Gate?
Evolve, Dragon Gate, and PWG.
See, I need to fuck with Evolve then.
Yeah.
It seems like Evolve, because they got the contract.
Smash in Toronto, I think. He's all over. He's from Baltimore. He's got a crazy story.
Smash?
Smash is like a Toronto promotion.
Okay.
He used to be like, he grew up in Baltimore, and he was like a gang member, and then he got into wrestling, and that got him out of like all that stuff. And now
so
he's
like
in the WWE.
Indie R-Truth.
He's like, but like legit, yeah, legit, like no bullshit. It's definitely not
indie truth.
It's not a part of his like persona anyway. But like, that's
see,
just
but
like
yeah,
something
but
about
Evolve
him.
Has that has the contract with the WWE. That's how Tommaso Ciampa and Johnny Gargano, which I'm gonna put at the beginning of this motherfucker on the audio at
oh,
least.
Oh yeah, friend of the show,
friend
Johnny
of the homie. He's a homie. So that's. We got that at the PWX at the Samoa Joe show, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I need to check that. I think they uploaded onto the place where I watch all my wrestling, watchwrestling.ch or TO, whatever the fuck it is.
Oh,
so
the
I need to, well, no, I mean, they just upload. I never watch an episode.
Oh, yeah. It was definitely like a more like laid-back style than he normally does in the indies, but it was still a great match.
Which one?
The when Johnny Gargano wrestled.
I didn't like. Have they wrestled a second time?
No, I think that's if not this week, next week on NXT.
I wasn't impressed. I mean, because it was the Gargano show, Tommaso Champion, which he was called by William Regal.
Yeah.
Tomato Champion. he held back and he let Gargano. So I hope it. You know, Gargano did all right. It was a weak roll up. I hope Tomato Champion actually gets his time to shine in the next time. Yeah. But I don't know if you listen to the New Day podcast, but it's weird. It's not going to be a popular thing, and not with you anyway. I don't see those guys on the main roster.
Oh, yeah. Johnny Gargano's watching them wrestle Tyler Breeze. I said this on the Fast in the World podcast. Tyler Breeze is very small, comparatively speaking, in WWE. But then looking at these guys, they were definitely like a lot smaller than even Tyler Breeze. So that doesn't...
That's like J&J, man.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah. So it doesn't look good, especially with Vince McMahon liking bigger guys, and especially since the only reason they got them there is their style, and they can't really work that style in the WWE because they want to wrestle like a little slower.
Yeah,
pace.
And plus, well, I mean, I'm just thinking aesthetic alone. I was just like, looking at... And, you know, I was talking to Nathan, and I was like, they looked like nerds. You know, they look like they didn't fit in. I mean, I go, hey, you know, like you have that yardstick to go by. He's like, well, do you see him in front of Randy Orton? Do you see any one of those guys in front of Randy Orton? Do you see any of those guys in front of someone, Dean Ambrose? Do you see any of those guys in front of, I don't know, let's just go down the roster. Do you see any of these guys in front of Kalisto even? And I go, no, I don't.
Well, Kalisto stole Gargano's move, that one move where Kalisto rolls them up for the pin and then pushes their ass like a little more and then kicks them in the face.
Mm-hmm.
That was Gargano's move at first.
Oh, the rolling kick thing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's a sick move, but Kalisto is just awesome. I'm not taking anything away from Gargano. I'm not taking anything away from Tommaso Ciampa. So don't get it twisted, people listening. Nathan, I know you're listening. I'm just saying, it's going to be tough. It's going to be real tough. On top of anybody from the NXT roster, it's even less than 1% of the people that are on that roster now are going to make it to the main roster.
Well, there's quite a few guys that can make money outside of WWE, and those two guys are one of them, or a few of them. So I think that they just did it to just kind of get on TV a few times and maybe just help their indie cred.
Well, that too, and I think in terms of tag team division, it's lacking in the WWE. It kind of stinks. And they got this huge thing, how many teams? 16? How many teams is it?
Oh, there's quite a few. I think it's definitely
the Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes thing. They weren't equipped, so they had to outsource motherfuckers. And so they're not on a deal. They don't have a deal at all. They just came in just to do this one job.
It seems like.
I mean, they're going to do the job later. I mean, who do you have winning that?
I think Samoa Joe and Finn Balor are going to win, and then some kind of way Joe's going to ask for a title shot, and that's going to be the takeover title match.
I would say the same thing.
I don't think they're going to win it. I think they're going to get all the way to the end, and Samoa Joe is going to turn heel and on Finn Balor. I think something's going to go down, and that's how it's not going to be no like, we're so good friends. Hey, buddy, let me get a title shot. Fuck no.
No, I think there'll be a turn for the title shot, but I think they'll end up winning.
Nope, it'll happen during that fucking Dusty Rhodes final against who?
Dusty Rhodes finish in the Dusty Rhodes tournament.
Well, no, it's going to be just a heel turn. It's just going to be like, fuck you. I was just milking, hanging with you, trying to get your fucking cred so I can get the opportunity at your belt. Why everybody got to be all chummy? This ain't the NBA.
Because it's for Dusty, man. We got to be chummy.
Can't be chummy for Dusty. You gotta heal it out for Dusty. Dusty put over so no Ric Flair without Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah, no doubt.
He gave him heat. Get Samoa Joe some heat, because I think at the best capacity that Samoa Joe could even be at is a heel, to a certain degree. But it's gonna be tough when you got two fat dudes on the main roster once he comes up, because he's coming up.
Well, what do you mean? Do you put him in a?
You put him in a tag team with Owens. That would be rocking.
What? Samoa Joe deserves his own run. I definitely think so. And he helps
Owens.
Yeah, exactly.
Of course he does, but he's not.
I can see them wrestling each other maybe in like a brawling style feud, like for the IC title or
but
something.
But not
like that.
If Joe's a heel.
Oh yeah.
And it's two heels.
Well, Joe's been a face in Ring of Honor, and that's when Ring of Honor, I think, was at its most popular, and TNA, when TNA was at its most peak. So, like, I think, like, Joe as a face has been proven to make money.
But he's mean, though. He's mean-looking. I mean, that guy, I don't want to see him as a baby face. I mean, on the main...
It's like a badass baby face, like a Lesnar or a Ronda Rousey
man,
or something like that.
Save that shit for Stone Cold Steve Austin. Save that shit for, like, Diesel and Razor Ramon.
That's already happened, though.
I know.
There
are no heels on the roster. So, if he was to get up there and be, like, a badass heel, like, just a shitty fucking piece of shit heel, like Kevin Owens can be if he works at it, just a piece of shit. Again, the best heel on the main roster is who?
Sheamus. Seth Rollins.
I'm just kidding.
Seth Rollins, he has too many people liking him.
Well, I think that's just what's going to happen.
The Miz is the greatest heel on that roster right now.
Yeah, you said this before, man. I don't know. I think there's a...
I didn't say he was the best performer or the best character.
He bothers me.
He bothers you?
Yeah.
Exactly.
He bothers the crap out of me.
Yeah, you want to see him get his ass whooped.
That's true.
He plays his role amazingly. Amazingly. Especially in this fucking DeBray Wyatt thing.
That was good.
That was hilarious. That was amazing stuff. So, without further ado, we just had to get a little conversation and try to grease up the old... the gears, and get into this Raw from Memphis, Tennessee, home of Jerry King Lawler, which I thought would probably be on commentary.
Yeah, it's kind of strange he doesn't do it. I guess, I don't know. He famously doesn't watch the shows he's not on, so he might not want to.
Well, I guess he'll be, no, actually it was Booker T. It was Jerry King. He came back last Thursday.
Yeah, he's on SmackDown now. Yeah, yeah. I think he kind of needs to retire. He's a post-heart attack, doesn't watch the product.
He still wrestles, man. Are you nuts?
I I mean,
really?
Yes, he still wrestles on the indies.
Well, yeah, he can do.
But he has to sign a waiver.
I think he likes. I think he likes the indies more than he does WWE.
Just likes getting the pop.
Yeah, he can do the car dealerships for the rest of his life in Memphis and just do his thing. I think he's earned it. He doesn't like traveling.
Yeah.
He's a good guy, but I don't know.
But it'd been nice to have the King in there just for that kind of pop. I mean, JR shows up to Oklahoma, you know, when they had him on. It was you know, they had to bring him out. He has to tip his hat and everything. So, I don't know. I just thought that was weird. If you were to rate this Raw, what would you give it? Let's start with Luke.
Maybe a 6 or 6.5.
Well, grade it. What grade? That's out of 10.
Oh,
grade?
Mm-hmm.
So that sounds like more like...
So a, like a C.
C? C minus a plus.
C. It's a solid C.
Solid C? Solid
with
C.
A solid C.
I'm going to go like B minus. I thought it was a little bit better than usual.
I think for a go-home show, it did the job. I give it an A minus. Surprisingly. Yeah. Surprisingly, yeah. I think it was good, but it wasn't great. I don't think it was bad enough to where I'd be like, well, I can nitpick. Because there was nothing really to nitpick at, honestly.
Yeah, it was a great show. I like the gold rope for Night of Champions.
Yeah,
that's kinda cool. Nice touch.
I was like, what's up with that? Because normally they've just gone all white.
Is that for Night of Champions? I thought it was for Connor's Cure.
I was just thinking that as soon as I said it. I thought it was for Night of Champions the whole time, but I might have just been like marking out a little bit.
Yeah, we're not going to edit that out. Botchamania right here, buddy.
Fuck it.
So we're just going to go down the card, who won, who lost, and then we're going to talk each match per match. If y'all got, you know, if you got... something to add, if you want to describe the match, because I know you want to break down one or two matches.
Oh, what?
One in particular. But, so, we got the New Day beating Primetime Players to retain the Tag Team Championships. We got the big statement on Paige for the tap out. We got Cena over Sheamus. We got a no match by Stardust and Neville.
Oh, what? No. Dude, that was the sickest shit all night, dude.
It was a no match.
I don't know. It was pretty sick.
Oh, you dug it? We'll get there. We get Nikki Bella. Sorry, Flair over Nikki Bella.
This is true.
Flair over Nikki Bella. We get Rusev. Yep, we got Cesaro over Rusev.
Mm-hmm.
And
you see that roll up? The roll up was nice.
And the there's a pun up with that. I will mention. And then we have a no contest between the show and Sting, but then we get Sting and Cena over the Big Show and Seth Rollins.
Amazing card.
Yeah, it was pretty good show. I mean,
season premiere.
By the way,
season premiere.
You know it was season premiere, right?
Yeah.
I mean, like 30 minutes later, did you not know? How about an hour and a half into it, did you not know it was a season premiere?
It was two season premiere. Miz TV premiered within the show, like a crazy wormhole.
That's right.
I forgot about that season premiere. It was like 17 billion season premiere fucking mentions in one goddamn night. I'll be honest, folks. I didn't watch live. I am a football fan. Football fan. NFL. And I watched a doubleheader. And I figured I'd watch Raw the next night. And that's why they did it. I mean, it becomes a season premiere because they got to go up against... It's not really a season premiere. Really?
Well, I think they try to go against...
It never goes off the air. How can it be a season premiere?
Exactly.
It never goes off the air.
Yeah, they love to pat themselves on the back. You know, they're the only ones counting these numbers. You know, they'll bring it up to us. You know?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty pathetic. You know?
I think they were really just trying to get all the non-football fans, because they knew the football fans were just going to go watch football, but that's why they put on, like... Show and Sting, because that's what people used to watch other than football.
But did they announce
it was like Monday Nitro again?
It was, especially.
When did they start promoting that?
Start promoting
at the beginning of the show.
See, that's bullshit. That's what I don't like about wrestling. Sometimes you want to talk about ratings. You want to get the ratings in. But everything has to be secretive. If you're trying to get a pop on the ratings, you're trying to get like people to watch or tune in. You want them talking prior to who's going to be there. But the WWE or wrestling in general, they try to keep things secret. So it's like, oh yeah, if you tune in, you may just see this. And I don't agree with it, especially with the way that they're working now.
I thought they were trying to get like maybe the channel surfers, if you will.
They did tweet like 30 minutes before the show a historic announcement.
But here's the thing.
It's fair warning.
You're talking about people in my age or a little bit older demographic. And those people want to know ahead of time. Like, if they're watching, like, an NBC, you know, channel or something like that, because that's USA, and they're watching, I don't know, like, what's a popular show on NBC?
I don't have cable.
Yeah, we don't watch
Arrow. I don't know.
Yeah, whatever. If they're watching, like, Friends or some shit, right? Or, like, Seinfeld, or I don't know. That's how much we give a shit about television. And they see an ad from USA promoting US, you know, WWE Raw, Monday Night Raw, and they go like, Sting's gonna be performing. You know, someone my age, a little bit older, is gonna be like, oh shit, let me tune in.
Yeah.
They're not gonna take that news like when, you know, like try to hear from the grapevine. So I'm like, yeah, fuck that. That's not how you bring people in. So I feel like it was a waste of a surprise. It shouldn't have been a surprise at all.
I don't know. I think that it was they were working off the cuff. I don't think that it was a surprise even then. They didn't know they were going to do it till like right there,
idiots.
Last minute.
Idiots. This is why wrestlers shouldn't be running that show.
Wait, you don't think wrestlers should be running Raw? You think
no? I think
like,
TV writers. I think actual. I mean, if you're talking, okay, people can be in place, but if you're talking about show runners, yeah, they should be there to make sure that like they get the proper. Promotions on top of things as possible. You know, you don't see Dana White being like, oh, be sure to watch fucking like UFC 265, just tune in and prepare to see who the fuck gonna fight. You know, it doesn't make sense. It's like, oh yeah, just grab bag. You know, like
it just goes back to Vince though.
Yeah.
Being the kind of guy everybody knows he is, he's willing to change things up to the hour of the show, the minute of the show.
See, that's bullshit.
And I feel like this week was a little bit of a, I've heard some of the reports on the ratings, and I think it was a little bit of a reactionary.
They haven't moved. What is it, 2.7 for like the past like 4 weeks? Yeah,
that's pretty shitty.
That's horrible. I mean, it's better than nothing. I mean, you still got almost 3 million people watching your product, but say.
This week it dropped again.
What was that like?
Wow!
I heard them say it was the lowest it's been in 18 years.
Oh shit! Really?
Well, until last week it was lowest in 18 years, and then the week before that was the lowest in 18 years.
I think it was. I want to say maybe like 2.4. Maybe.
You got well. 2.5. Football. That's football, baby. And Monday Night Football, they probably got like 3 million people watching.
Yeah.
Monday Night Football.
Yeah.
I think they said it was like 14, 15.
Yeah. 14. Like,
per game?
I don't remember if it was. They referred to it as a doubleheader, so mm-hmm. I would assume maybe they're taking the whole thing. And,
yeah.
Okay. TNA famously would always, like, year after year get 1-1 for every Impact. So that shows you, like, the core wrestling fan. So they're only getting, like, they used to get, like, double the core wrestling fan, but now they're getting just, like, a little over, so that's pretty interesting. Or maybe they're all watching, like, I mean, we just said we don't watch on TV. Maybe everyone's on the internet.
Yeah,
we are.
Yeah.
We're watching. And I did.
The plus three.
And I did a great job because normally people get mad about people posting. Like, if they're not watching, people posting. Like, don't get online, man. Don't jump on Twitter. I did everything. I didn't jump on Instagram. I didn't do anything. The only thing I caught mention of today was when I opened up Instagram and I saw Nikki Bella. It was quick. As soon as I saw it, I fucking just closed it instantly. The Bellabration.
Oh yeah.
And I was like, oh, she must have won.
That's awful. Well, shit, man.
Well, yeah. So let's start with you want to kick it off with the opening segment.
Yeah, sure. The Authority come out and just pretty much run down like Night of Champions, run down that Singh is going to be on the main event tonight against the Big Show, and then they introduce the New Day and Stephanie McMahon and Triple H. Dance, gyrate with the New Day before the primetime players come out.
Wait a minute, dude. Slow down.
Well, I mean, they didn't really talk about shit. I mean, Sting came out. Not, you know, they. I hate these.
Well, segments. I just. But my, the one thing I want to say to this, and it reminds me of the last time they came out like it was like a game show, and it's like, well, they run down the card, and it was all like when they brought in the New Day, it was almost like they were introducing a band. It was just like, I thought they were like Dick Clark or something.
They were like the MCs for the evening.
Yeah, you know, but like, and first up, we have the New Day. You know, and I was just waiting for them to show up with like a guitar and a drum and maybe a trombone. But it was just like a weird thing. I don't like this sort of like, sort of vaudeville kind of introduction. I don't like that.
I think it's like dated. Like they've been doing this since the Attitude Era, having like this like 10 to 20 minute promo at the beginning of Raw. I think that's...
Well, it's one thing to do a promo. It's another thing to host the beginning of a show.
Well, I think, you know...
Like, it's like some sort of... Like, it's Midnight Special or some shit. You're like Don Cornelius at fucking... And Soul Train or some shit.
Well, I think maybe bringing it down before the third hour, like, with a big promo might help. But, like, they need to maybe kick off Raw with, like, maybe the Cena-Sheamus match. Maybe a match to that caliber every... Like, to kick off. Especially if it's not already going to be the main event. I think that would be, like, more... Like, up to today's speed. Like, because people are going to be, like, we talked about, like, flipping through the channels. They're going to be flipping through the channels at the most of the beginning. So if they see, like, John Cena wrestling, it means more than, like, Triple H talking, you know? Mm-hmm.
Obviously, but here's the thing. If you're going to, if we have no other choice but to receive, like, you know, 8 to 12 to 15 minute promo at the beginning, okay, I'll deal with that. I'll deal with you talking shit, running down somebody, fucking, like, healing it out or baby facing it up, that's fine. But when it turns into, like, and tonight we're gonna have this, and tonight we're gonna have that. And I just go like, well, fuck that type of 15-minute promo at the beginning, because it's not even a promo no more. You're fucking Dick Clark, you know? Yeah. Like, I don't want to be sitting here like, you know, like I'm looking at Laughing or like, you know, the Jimmy Fallon show. You know, I'm watching wrestling. So do a wrestling thing. Don't do like a TV game show host type of deal. Fuck that. That's dumb.
Two things I thought were interesting about the big intro by Stephanie and Hunter. Number one, I didn't know if they were faces or heels, because it changed throughout the entire thing.
Yeah, for sure.
They came out, pointed at Connor's cure, like, oh, look at all the good we do.
I was
and then they come down and run their mouth. And then Triple H builds up Sting, almost like a smaller version of what Sting did 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like you said, they ended up dancing.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah.
I'm not sure exactly what to make of all this.
Here's this thing about Connor's cure, but meanwhile, we're going to screw two guys that are going up against our golden child.
Oh, and when they listed all the great stars that had came out this year to crickets.
Yeah. I thought that was funny as fuck. They say Cena, they say Seth, but then they get to Cesaro, and then they get
Roman Reigns.
Oh, yeah. And then it just like, okay.
She sped up towards the end. I don't know if you noticed.
Yeah, this is not working. Fuck.
Yeah, because I think the first one that kind of dropped was Cesaro. And it was like the first one outside the main guys. And Yeah, we got all these stars. No, you fucking don't.
But if you watch mid-carders.
I mean, but if you watch, like, Cesaro got cheered when he came out. Like, Sasha got cheered mildly when she came out. So I think people, I really do think people are tired of just this 20-minute promo at the beginning. Because, like, Seth Rollins got boring chants last week. I mean, I really think they need to change up just, like, the way they put Raw together.
When I watch it live, I know that I can start tuning in about 8:30.
Yeah.
Because my DVR started, so I can just fast forward through the beginning and catch back up.
This is true. So. I mean, there you go.
So the first match was the Primetime Players versus the New Day. Something I noticed in this is that the New Day was rocking the Harlem Heat gear.
Oh, yeah.
I thought that was pretty...
The new colors.
Yeah. Well, they always got different schemes for their outfits, so they're kicking out a pretty penny to do that stuff. I mean, they're really invested in this tag team. But, the Harlem Heat... And it's funny, too, because I was listening... Maybe I was listening to the Solid Monster Sounds Off, and he mentioned... Someone asked a question about the Harlem Heat facing the Dudley Board. Did you know what I'm talking about?
I've heard about this.
And I think that's something they're working towards.
At WrestleMania is what I heard.
Because Booker T and What's the tag team name?
Stevie Ray.
Stevie Ray. They're actually down. That's why Booker T's been gone. They've actually been working down in Texas in Booker T.
Booker T's wrestling school. Yeah.
No, his wrestling promotion.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's a,
I think it's, I forgot what it's called. Do you know what it is?
I know it's out of Houston. I know they got, they have like TV, like local TV in Texas, and they do real well. They do like,
San Antonio?
I think Houston.
Houston?
But yeah, Stevie Ray and Booker T were at heads, I know, for a number of years, so it's good to see that they're even...
Yeah, well, they're working out. It looks like we're going to be fucking 1992 all over again.
Well, and 1990,
what is it? It would be
92 through 97.
Yeah, I was going to say 97, maybe.
I love Harlem Heat.
Man. Harlem Heat were fucking fantastic.
And dude. I heard...
The music, when I hear that music...
Heard something about the Hardys and another TLC match.
Oh, God.
Yeah, they're supposed to sign Jeff Hardy as well, so maybe they can do Harlem Heat.
Maybe we can have a three-way.
Yeah, I mean, they're not doing anything with the tag division anyways. We could do Harlem Heat versus the Hardy Boys.
It's 97 all over again.
I guess that's pretty awesome, but that's pretty sad, man. Poor Lucha Dragons. Oh, it's real sad.
Poor The Ascension.
Poor PTP. You know, and it's like... who's living in the past? You know, I think a lot of people...
I am. I would love to see that for the record.
Well, you got a lot of marks, you know, that are pro, like, new generation. This is why you love NXT, right?
Yeah.
That's why a lot of people love... That's why you love NXT. Because it's the new blood. I'm sick of the Big Show. Please retire. I'm sick of Randy Orton versus Cena. I'm sick of Cena. I'm sick of all of this. And... Now all the things change because the Dudley Boys. I feel like you should be as pissed off about the Dudley Boys coming back. And then Sting. You know, like these. You know, people should be pissed about this.
Well, one thing is,
what's up with these? What happened to the youth movement?
Well, okay. Well, one thing about the Dudley Boys is, I feel like Bubba Ray Dudley or Bully Ray in TNA has done nothing but trying to improve since he's been gone with WWE. Whereas like other guys just like have been riding the WWE like. I don't know, like a cane maybe. So like, I would say like they've worked just as hard as people that are new coming up. So when you see them again, you're like, hell yeah, they're back. And then, whereas like, yeah, like guys like, yeah, Triple H, Kane that have been just like milking a paycheck, not really doing shit, for a while. I think it's a little different. And plus they're helping the younger guys. A mid card, like, what's it called when you like, want to like watch something from nostalgia. A mid-card nostalgia pop is way different than a main event nostalgia pop. Like if you watch Japan, they bring them down, like Jushin Thunder Liger opens the show, mm-hmm. in AAA, like the older guys open the show. So like I feel like there's a spot for these guys, just not in the main event. I don't know.
I would like to see them win the titles again.
I knew you would.
I love the Dudleys.
Yeah. I mean, I don't.
And I think a lot of the nostalgia factor though is. People are so sick of what it is now, and they want what they had as kids.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because they remember that being good, so that's what they remember as being good. So when they see someone like the Dudleys come back, or the Hardys, or Edge and Christian, or Sting.
But you have to take consideration, too. These live shows.
But it's moved on 20 years.
These live shows.
These guys are 20 years older.
True.
These live shows, whether it's live or taped, SmackDown, you know, even the house shows, it's flooded with children. I would say, you know, a good 60, almost 70% of the crowd are children.
Oh, one of the things babies. I hate is there's...
And it's kind of tough to sell...
Well, a good worker can work through a nostalgia pop and get, like, a current response now, I feel like. I feel like, Jeff Hardy wrestled the Dudley Boys, but in TNA, he's... Kids love him down there. He's one of the only guys that make any money.
Yeah, because he's there long enough. I mean, and you're talking, like, there's TNA kids like it is WWE kids in the stands?
No.
I'm saying,
TNA kids are the ones that were hanging out at Universal Studios while they got free tickets.
They
need some IC.
This might be true, but I know they do cheer for Jeff Hardy when he does come out. So
I do like Jeff Hardy, though. So.
Yeah.
I think he's one of the few people that TNA has that's
Well, he's gone.
He's worth anything. Oh, is his contract over?
Him, no more Willow.
Yeah, him and Kurt Angle, like, both pretty much said, like...
Well, Kurt's in, his contract's through January.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's, like...
Yeah, but their contract's done out for TV now.
No, the TV is going to run through the end of the year now. Oh. That's what they're saying. They're going to run
come on, TNA Destination. Come on, Destination America.
I think TNA is...
Make up your fucking mind.
So now it may not be the last pay-per-view, the one we wanted to go to.
Oh, man.
Bound for Glory may not be the last TNA pay-per-view. As much as I'd hoped.
Bound for Gore? I mean, they're done. I mean, I guess it's just going to get absorbed into GFW. I think that's what's ultimately...
I think that's what will happen.
I think that's
GFW will be TNA.
Yeah. I mean, Jeff Jarrett started it, so it should ironically just end up in Jarrett hands. You know?
Yeah, the Carter.
It'll
the
be
Carter,
interesting to see what they do with it.
The Carter family.
Apparently,
is
they're
a
doing
bunch
real
of
well with the tapings in Vegas and everything.
In Vegas,
I heard the Vegas tapings were good, and then I saw pictures of about 150 people when Kevin Nash headlined.
Oh yeah,
a couple weeks later.
And the
like
baseball
baseball shows.
Yeah, the baseball shows aren't doing too well.
So
I don't think
those are doing well. But I've heard a couple people say the Vegas shows did well. So
yeah, I think they can get them when they need to. So.
Well, they just fucking stay in Vegas. Sorry to get off track, guys. We're just talking a little shit. But okay, so what happens here? You get Stephanie and Triple H dance, and that was pretty funny.
Yeah, that was pretty funny.
I enjoyed that.
I liked Xavier Woods throughout this match. He's always talking shit. I saw Titus O'Neil doing the nene, and then Xavier Woods was very appalled, saying that they created the nene, that New Day created the nene, and he just like it just cracked me up, man. I might have just. You know.
When he did the Pink Panther.
Yeah, he had the Pink Panther.
Right on the side of the ring.
Yeah. He's very protective over that trombone, too. There's a spot where Darren tries to grab it. He's like, don't touch my trombone!
Yeah.
Don't touch my trombone! They fucked him up because he always touched the trombone. And then he gets on the apron to do the distraction and...
Tyson rips it away
from
him.
He whips out, like, the pull part.
The slide.
And then Trouble in Paradise... it's delivered to
Titus O'Neil.
No.
What?
To Darren Young on the outside, which results in a distraction to O'Neil, where I think Big E like just fucks him up somehow. I'm not sure even how he even fucked him up, but it led to Kofi coming in and hitting the big end on top, you know, the crashing big end. The New Day get the win. Then the Dudley boys, they step out onto the ramp.
That was after Kofi fell off the announce table. I don't
know yes!
Caught that.
Yes, he did fall off.
Trying to put the cowboy hat on. Yeah.
This motherfucker can walk and do the most amazing shit to prevent from getting thrown out of the Royal Rumble, but he can't stay on a fucking announce table.
Yeah, he tried. It was a valiant effort. He was waving his arms.
JBL just couldn't let it go either.
Yeah, he did mention it.
No, well, he kind of gave him away.
He was like, hold on there.
You get up here, Kobe. You get up here. Oh, that was fucking funny.
And we get a little glimpse of a Flair promo, which was kind of cool, into a page with only Becky, Charlotte's getting ready, versus Sasha Banks. This match was pretty good, I thought. What did you guys think of this match?
Fuck this match.
Really? Oh, dude, Sasha working the arm in the early
going. I would rather Paige have won. I'm a big Paige fan, though. Oh. I like Sasha Banks. Don't get me wrong, I think she's good, but I really like Paige.
So. I just don't care. This doesn't move any needles, dude.
Oh, what?
This moves no needles. No. I mean, yeah, it was a good match.
Sasha tapping out Paige is...
Again.
Is just as big of a deal as when she tapped out Nikki. Paige is just as over as Nikki. She doesn't need the belt to be over where Nikki does. That's the only difference, I would say.
I'm going to throw a wild card at you.
Yeah?
What if Becky Lynch was Sister Abigail?
No, I'm not buying that.
Because I've heard they might be bringing a Sister Abigail in.
Yeah, they're probably bringing
up
NXT.
She's the only person I think currently that could maybe pass it off. And that might be interesting.
Mm-mm. Nope.
You think it's going to be a worker?
It's too...
Like,
hey, you said who?
I would like to see it be a worker.
Paige.
Like a wrestler.
To have a female member of the Wyatt family.
Yeah,
I don't want to see a female member of the Wyatt family. It goes to shit after that. It goes to complete garbage.
Oh, I don't know. If she can work.
No, we don't need it. I think it's for what they're building up in this super intimidating beard growing faction, the last thing they need is a female member. I'm sorry. That's like saying like, oh yeah, they should have a dude in Team Bad. Like, can you imagine that?
They do. To me.
Oh, stop. Stop! That's horrible! That's horrible! That's horrible.
It's fine.
God! Whew, we don't need no feminist heat in this motherfucker. No, but, but I just... Who did you say? Paige?
No, I said Becky Lynch.
Becky Lynch? See, I got... I got other plans for Becky Lynch. You know, like winning the title.
Okay.
Off of Nikki Bella.
But I'm saying if there's a bunch of we're just going down the thought process. If like this Sister Abigail does have the title and has these like gigantic dudes protecting her, that could be like
a Sorry, whole other bro.
Dynamic.
Hey, cool. It's not like they're gonna have fucking Braun Strowman choking out fucking Charlotte Flair. I'm sorry, that's just not
ECW.
It's not happening. It's not happening. They're not trying to get like a lawsuit up in that motherfucker.
But Sasha Banks does tap out Paige, I think, for the second time, and she has tapped out Nikki. I do think that she's gonna get the title either off of Charlotte or Nikki, whoever that may be.
Well, Tamina, it was a Tamina involvement. I think there was a sort of a dive off of the top rope.
Yeah. Paige
was a front flip.
Yeah, Paige was doing the like the running Billy Kidman senton thing off the apron, and then Tamina pulled him out of the way.
Well, something that you mentioned before, it's really at first I considered Naomi kind of the leader because she's, you know. Like, she's the one that's been in the forefront for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But as you see with these last matches, that it's becoming more apparent that Sasha is the one, and Tamina and Naomi are her goons.
Yeah.
And, yeah, you mentioned that. I didn't see it coming, but it's becoming more and more apparent. But I still see her ultimately becoming a babyface after all of this. After all of this.
Cause Sasha?
Sasha. Because her and Becky Lynch have to fucking have their feud. I'm telling you.
Well, why would she have to be... So you're saying Becky Lynch would turn heel and Sasha would turn face instead of them
We've
just
talked
staying.
About this before. I've told you how this would work out before.
I don't know.
Like, I see Becky Lynch backstabbing whoever the fuck ever, maybe Becky Lynch, on their way to get the title, and then... The best baby face you can get. The best baby
Wait,
face you
Becky
can get.
Becky Lynch backstage Becky Lynch?
No, Becky Lynch backslash
Probably Paige
Sasha
or
Banks.
Charlotte? Or?
I say Sasha Banks. And then how about... Because the ultimate baby face right now is on the Divas card is Sasha Banks. And if
is
she,
that Charlotte?
No. It's Sasha Banks. She's the most over out of all of them. We
yeah,
want Sasha...
Well, yeah, but she's getting saved by these goons, like you said.
But she's still over because she's a boss. That's what bosses do. She got goons.
Well, you can be over as a heel, and I feel
she
like she's...
She has a female J&J.
Yeah.
Sorry. She's a boss. Bosses have goons. People love her for that shit. And you know, it's funny, but she, at some point, she has to be the ultimate babyface. She's going to have to chase the title. And she's going to have to chase the title off of someone who's wronged her. And right? You really want to get behind her? Let her ass get wronged somehow. Boom. Instant heat on not only Becky Lynch, because, again, she's winning that title. And then Sasha Banks going to get it. You want to see someone over? Have her go after that Divas belt, especially after Becky Lynch. I just say it makes sense. It makes so much sense. It makes sense to me.
I don't know. Well, then we had that second...
But after the Banks statement, Team Bad basically... beat the shit out of
the one woman down team PCB with just being up Paige and Becky.
Yeah, they beat the shit out of them.
Yeah, healing out a little bit there. And then season premiere of Miz TV with Miz and the Wyatt family. I think Miz did a great job of being really great scared job. Here. Yeah. Especially when like you saw
You're not safe here.
Yeah, Harper and Braun like threw their chairs out. Wei sat down and Bray sat down, and then you saw Miz sitting down just like as he would, and Bray stopped him, and then the like cartoon like face of the Miz was just cracking me up.
Yeah,
But
and plus he pulled like what's his name, Gray, David. What's the reporter for ESPN, the guy who interviewed LeBron James for the announcement.
Oh, I'm not sure.
David Gray or something Gray, but he pulled a David Gray. I just say David, where it's just like he's talking. He interrupts him. He's want to be scared as shit, but he's still the interviewer. So he's like, you want this? He's like, well, what do you want? And I was like, that's pretty fucking ballsy of The Miz. But at the same time, it fucking adds to how great he is as a character.
The response was great.
It was amazing.
One of the best promos this year.
Oh, yeah.
By far.
I feel like Bray's promos have been getting a little stale because I think from watching now, they've been like a little bit behind the curtain. Like they're getting a little stale because they're always on the Titantron. So seeing him out, even on a segment like Miz TV, it was like a big deal because you used to see him just on the screen, and now you see him out in front of the people, and it was even especially more.
With those two goons living behind him at 7 feet tall.
Yeah,
it was monsters.
Fucking, it was nuts.
And I think the most impressive thing about this segment, that Bray response was great. That promo was great. Roman Reigns held his own.
Great Roman
Reigns. I was like, what the hell?
You gotta give my man credit.
Just happened. I sat flabbergasted.
Yeah.
It was a shoot. It was a definite shoot. And I'm like, where the fuck has this been the whole time? Where has it been? Roman, I know you watched the show. I know you watched the show.
I'm telling you, if you would let Roman Reigns just run and be a natural person like they do Bray,
Roman,
you would get good promos all the time.
I know hopefully. You watch this show.
Hopefully.
Where the fuck has that been? Like, I don't know. It's been sometimes he hasn't been scripted. And sometimes he's been scripted by Paul Heyman. But man, whatever the fuck you ate that day, you know, whatever you like, whatever latte you got or something, or whatever conditioner you put in your hair that day, whatever comb you used or like trim or whatever, keep using that shit. Go baseball superstition on a motherfucker. Keep that up. Keep promos like this up. And you know what? You got a fan out of me, Mr. Kick, Punch, Slap, Punch, Kick, Clothesline, Punch, Kick, Slap.
Well, he like teased a little bit about how like family means a lot to him. And that opens up a lot of people for the mystery partner. Like Rikishi, The Rock, who else? Quite a few people. Tamina.
I heard Kane was one of the people were saying.
I think it's going to be Kane.
The Demon Kane?
I think it's going to be Kane.
He has unfinished business with Seth Rollins. Why the fuck would he show up and do this little piece of shit crap?
Because Bray talks about killing monsters or, you know.
Yeah, and I think that, I mean, people have also been saying Rowan, which I think would fit well with, like, having him prove, like, someone's breaking out of the cult or whatever. But I think he's just too fucked up, too fucked up still. So, like, I think Kane, they've said that Kane was ready for SummerSlam, but he still wasn't there. Brian, I think, is ready as well.
He's just not being cleared by
WWE. I don't want to see Brian in that shit either. I mean, I guess if it's Kane, I guess I have another choice. I mean, he has to come out as the Demon Kane.
I think Kane and Brian would be two big pops, which is what you're doing for this mystery partner. So
I heard Jericho's name tossed around as well. Wow, that'd be they said Jericho still has unfinished business.
But it has to be someone but who's he also an has equalizer been, to right. Braun.
That was what I thought when I heard that. Yeah. You know, he's not big enough, I don't think.
Because my thing was the Big Show, but he's all in a month. Old. No, well, he's already in the program. He's already in the program. I mean, he's not gonna. My whole thing
the
is
monsters
this.
Are old.
Who's someone who's right now not out? Say like you know Jericho or like Kane or anything like that. I'm talking about on the roster right now. Can Ron not fucking like hang from his shoulder? The Big Show. That's it. So
but then you don't want to give that away now. Then you want to wait a little bit.
I mean, that's why it makes sense to say Kane, but I'm thinking he has unfinished business. I'm not saying that it's a bad idea. I just go like, well, they got unfinished business.
I wouldn't really like to see Kane in that Kane match. Would come. He would be my pick.
I think Kane would come back as with the mask and everything.
Oh, yeah, probably the biggest pop of the night.
Yeah, with the fire.
He would be a face, I guess.
Yeah, I think he'd come back as a face.
Well, do you remember just what happened to him?
I know. That's what I'm saying. I guess he would come back as a face, almost like the Daniel Bryan Kane.
And his unfinished business is Seth Rollins.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, maybe you give him that hot win and pass him on to
Hot
and then Rollins. Seth loses to Sting that night.
Are you out of your mind? We got a prediction.
Stingless Kane?
By the way.
Wishful thinking.
Harlem Heat versus Dudley Boy.
By the way.
WWF Thunder.
If you... MTV Heat. So check this shit out. By the way, this is part one of Peter and Jake Talks Wrestling episode 56. Part two will be our, being this is a go-home show, will be our predictions for Night in Champions 2015. So before we start jumping the gun on who's going to win what, we have an entirely different video and audio for you punk jabroni motherfuckers. Let's go ahead and move forward to Cena versus Sheamus, which I thought wasn't that bad of a match.
It's a good match. Solid match.
No, solid. I think Sheamus, I think Sheamus versus Orton is probably the worst of it. I mean, you can put Sheamus with a pretty much anybody, and I think you'll get a squeeze a good match out of him.
Nah.
It's just something about Orton that just sucks the living...
No, opposite. If you put Cena and Orton in a match, that's going to be a great match every time. But if you put Sheamus in a match, that's going to... You're hoping that the other guy can get a good match out of him. I think Sheamus is bad. Like
he's boring.
It's been a while though since the two of them fought. I mean, I thought it was pretty fresh.
I'd like to see him cash that stupid thing in. That so I'd like to see him around as much.
Well, I mean, don't back out. Did I just hear beep beep beep? You're backing out, or you thought it was a good match?
It was a good match, but I think Sheamus is boring the majority of the time. I don't think if you put him in a match with anybody, it would be a good match.
I think he does well with anybody. When he had that shit against Neville, when he first came back, it was interesting stuff. Even though he whooped Neville's ass, I mean, he had to cheat to win, which I thought was pretty badass, because that's what I wanted. That's something I asked for, right? I was like, just come back as a heel. And he came back as a heel. He started beating up the little guys. I was like, this is great.
Yeah, Neville's a great worker. That's Neville could hide Sheamus's flaws, I think.
Stop. You just got a bias against Sheamus. I just don't like when Sheamus faced Orton.
He looks so stupid.
When he went up against, when he goes up against Cesaro, is awesome. Because they just, two big lugs, like
stiff. Cesaro's such a good.
It's strong style. Yeah. It's strong style. They're beating the living shit out of each other.
No, but if you look, I think
every match you've mentioned, the other person is like Jake said. It's the other person.
There's a ring general.
Don't take away. Don't take away from Sheamus. I mean, I'm not a fan, but I'm not going to take away.
No,
take
the only. I mean, he got beat up by Yoshitatsu in the back for stealing Yoshitatsu's milkshake maker.
I remember that. He didn't beat up. He did not get beat up.
That's what everyone said.
No, it was heat. Something went down, but didn't beat up Sheamus.
Either Sheamus stepped down or Sheamus got beat up.
They fought.
Over a milkshake maker. And Yoshitatsu got it back.
Two things. Sheamus, which I thought was pretty interesting. The 10 beats of the Bauer drum or whatever the fuck that's called. This is like his babyface move. But he was able to pull off all 10 beats. And that's what I thought was pretty interesting. I was like, how did he get through that? Only to find out it was going to get returned by John Cena. John Cena returns 10 and wins with the AA.
Yeah, hell yeah.
I did think it was good when Sheamus was going to do this number and he was showing that it hurt from where Cena had got him. Yeah, I was like, okay, attention to detail. That doesn't happen a lot.
Yeah, he called himself, because he's not a babyface anymore. He's a heel. You know, those little details, that's a little detail thing too.
Heel or face, they should pay attention to those details.
I don't know. I just think that those things like that is like, yeah, it doesn't, because he's not the guy to do that and be a badass anymore. He's like, this kind of hurts. You know, there's a little flaws in the heel. I don't know. But Cena wins with one AA. I thought that was pretty weird. Just laid him out, jabroni. Get out of here.
Exactly.
Sheamus, there you go. And if you try to come with that, he's going to cash in and get the championship because he's losing. Not this time around. Not this feud.
Not Sheamus. What if Sting wins and then Sheamus versus Sting next pay per view or something crazy like that?
I think he fails his cash in. That's not gonna be much for him to do.
Ryback with the real shitty promo with Kevin Owens coming out.
Okay. Owens. Ryback. I know you're probably watching this show.
The secret on a pole match.
You're probably watching this show with Roman Reigns. All right. I know you're watching. One thing. And trust me, I'm a record collector, and I love my music, and I love my Elvis. Elvis is from Nashville. Everything that Elvis did, Nashville. Sun Records, Nashville. It's not that you just so happen to be in Memphis, and you do a dumb Elvis thing, because Elvis has nothing to do with Memphis. He has one album, it's called Elvis in Memphis. Why? Because he's from fucking Nashville. All right? That just that ate me alive. That made me pretty upset.
Is Wrasslin in Nashville? I thought it was in Memphis.
Everything's in Nashville.
Oh, okay.
Everything's in Nashville.
Not a big Elvis fan.
Yeah, not a big...
Love Elvis.
What in the...
Dan Grandi would know.
I thought your dad was on the bus yesterday.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I ran into him on the way back from Walmart, so... But that's all. That just peed me. You listen to the Torch, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember when, was it Bruce Mitchell got really upset because somebody was talking about the numbers, some sort of numbers or something? He got really pissed off. And he just shot on fucking, I guess, New York Times number, like wrestling numbers for the WWE or some shit like that.
Mm-mm,
you don't remember that? He got pissed off. He's like, this is Bush League shit. Like, this is what I do. Don't be fucking playing with the thing and thinking that you're running the column. You know, no. Your shit's wrong. That's how I felt about that promo. Him, that one little Elvis thing. And I digress.
It was crickets during that part.
Because they're like, no.
It was terrible.
Because I think the crowd was like, no, Elvis is from fucking Nashville, you jackass.
I don't know. I think they would have, he was singing, he was
gyrating his hips.
I don't think
I was actually watching it today, and my roommate and everybody was just like cooking, and they came in to shit on this segment. So that shows you, like, right there.
Any non wrestling fan. The crowd itself didn't care about the singing and the dancing as much as they got the wrong city. Like, Nashville's Music City, USA.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's
for sure
music. I mean, Nashville, you know, whatever, but music is Memphis. So when you bring up a Nashville artist in Memphis...
Memphis is the blues place, right?
Well, it's Stax. It's rhythm and blues.
Right, okay.
Rhythm and blues. Muscle Shoals, McLemore. Yeah, that's... I think even American is there. But Nashville, yeah. Sun Records is Nashville. But sorry about that, guys.
And then we had Stardust and the Ascension versus.
Oh wait! Oh yeah. So they talk about the secret.
That one, yeah.
Owens shot on. He shat.
He brings it out, holds it up, and says, "Anyone who believes this garbage is true." I never read the secret, so I don't know what's in it. But
it's just a book about positivity.
Oh well, I mean.
I thought it was a good. I thought it was like a new wave heel promo. Like I'm gonna shoot on what you read.
I mean, that shows you that he's thinking about shit throughout the day. He went to the Barnes & Noble.
Yeah, he did.
Got the secret. He brought it to the arena. Like,
I feel like part of that was improv by Owens too.
I think
and,
so.
And Ryback, like when the.
Or maybe he just
like
went
the cover
back.
Came off. He was like, "You missed a piece."
Yeah, but
he crumbled it up right in and like threw it in his face. That's perfect.
But I think he made a great point, and I think this is the mind games that he's going to play with Ryback, and I think it's really good mind games. Even though it's like a new way to heal out on somebody on what you read. Apparently, this book means a lot to Ryback, and he's like, "Fuck this book," you know. And I don't know. You could tell that it was like. It really got to him, you know? I think it got to him. I think even kayfabe, breaking kayfabe, I don't think he's pretty happy about that promo.
I don't know.
It meant so much
to
him.
I really don't think WWE Creative came up with that. I think that was a Kevin Owens
special.
It definitely was a Kevin Owens thing. All right, it seemed like that to me.
I would like.
It called him weak-minded. It's for weak-minded people. And then, yeah, we find out that they're going to face... We get another match for Night of Champions. I think out of all of that.
Versus Ryback.
Yeah, because he's still probably pissed that he helped Rollins win... Help him win over him from last SmackDown. Do you remember? He was part of
the Lumberjack match.
Yeah.
And, I saw the highlights, but I didn't watch.
And as Ryback is about to shell shock...
Kevin Owens literally just like stood to the side the whole match.
I didn't even know he was that.
He had nothing to do with it. He was like, "Why am I out here?" Like, I'm too good for this kind of thing.
I didn't even know he was out there.
And then it all got cleared out. There was, like, a big melee, like, an outside move.
And then there's Owens.
And then all of a sudden there's Owens.
Just tell it.
There you go.
It was probably one of the most perfect.
I think this
was great.
This is a great build for Owens. Like, winning the NXT title, like, feud with John Cena into possible IC title run, maybe, and then definitely IC title feud. I think this is... This shows you that they're really trying to work with Owens.
Well, do you think this feud has legs?
Oh yeah, yes. I think Ryback.
Three good matches.
I think this is the exact.
At least three.
This is
could get five.
This is the exact same dynamic as the Cena feud, like a guy the kids would like, a guy like the girls like, a big muscle bound guy that Kevin Owens can like shit on in a way that the right people cheer and the right people boo. I think this is perfect, especially for the IC title.
I just hate that Ryback is so fucking vanilla.
Oh, well, I think we're the demographic.
I take your negativity and I put it in me stomach. Negativity in my stomach. Hatred.
I really want to like Ryback.
I do, yeah.
Like, I really do. Something inside of me really wants to like that guy, but he's just so cheesy.
Yeah.
Like, it's all so cheesy. It's just so damn cheesy and cornball.
He's pretty vanilla.
And I can't get behind it as much as I really want to.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, it's bad. It doesn't fit him. And plus, stealing victories is just not... It's just like, what? Just beat the fuck out of people and pin them. Don't steal wins.
I think he should be like... He should have been built up like a Goldberg.
Yeah.
Like, unstoppable. They did that for a second, then people like called him out, if you will. They started chanting Goldberg and everything. And I think that like got him a little fearful of doing it, which is weird because, I mean, before Goldberg, there was Ultimate Warrior. It goes back a little bit before that. But
here's the thing about Goldberg. Goldberg came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And he just shocked the world the way that they built him. I still think today Goldberg is probably the best build for any wrestler.
Didn't he have over like 100 wins?
Yeah. Oh,
before
it was
he
well
was defeated, like
yeah.
by Diesel, by Kevin Nash, with some bullshit.
They started him real low.
And Hogan was supposed to be in that match, wasn't he? And he didn't want to do the job.
No. He won the U.S. title, and then he won in the Georgia Dome. He beat Scott Hall and Hulk Hogan in the same night to win the world title, which is unheard of at the time. Like to have two matches. And if you watch the Scott Hall match, like they get in each other's face, and Goldberg pushes him, and the whole place like blows up, like as if the fucking Rock comes out. Like, it's nuts. Like it's fucking cool. Like if you watch Scott Hall versus Goldberg, that's the match. Hogan versus Goldberg is just as over, but like that one, the first bump Scott Hall takes, it's a fucking amazing. Like the whole place, it's where the Atlanta Falcons play. It's in the Georgia Dome, so it's like 80,000 people.
Back when WCW had those huge...
And this was a Nitro. This wasn't... WrestleMania was in the Georgia Dome for WrestleMania 27. This was a Nitro. And Goldberg...
Michael Buffer announced it.
Yeah, 1 week build, they sold out the Georgia Dome because of Goldberg.
He's an Atlanta kid.
Yeah. It was fucking nuts, man. If you go back and watch it.
Fully before, your favorite Goldberg match?
Oh, Scott Hall versus Goldberg.
I have no. I don't have a favorite.
Diamond one. Dallas Page, Halloween Havoc.
Really?
That match. That's a perfect match. That reversal out of the jackknife into the fucking. Because he had the hurt arm. Because he tried to dive at him and he fucking busted his arm. It was a
pole?
Straight shoot. Yeah, straight shoot. He gets him up. He's like, he doesn't get him up. He was supposed to get him up.
Yeah.
And Diamond Dallas Page just went fucking rogue. Fucking. You talk about a pop. That was a pop. Because you thought he was going to win.
Yeah.
Motherfuckers in the front row, they're like, what a con. But, you know, Goldberg wins. But it's still, like, just in terms of, like, drama, just one of the best. I put that in my top three best favorite matches of all time.
Damn.
With one of my favorite wrestlers.
Yeah, see, that's...
He even loses, and I'm still over. It's still over with me, you know?
That's what you could do with Ryback, but I guess... people are too smart nowadays, maybe a different culture, maybe they didn't do the right things, I don't know.
So what's so great about this no match between like Stardust and Neville?
Oh, the Lucha
Cosmic Wasteland.
Yeah.
The Lucha Dragons. Okay, first of all, they all three Lucha Dragons and Neville all run in, trip all the heels, bounce off the ropes, in the same time do a head scissors to the Ascension, taking them out, bounce off the ropes, bounce off the other ropes, going through, do a suicide dive into an arm drag. What the? That's some shit right there, man. That's some good shit. That's some fucking wrestling shit. And then in the ring, Neville does a head scissors, taking Stardust out, and then they just dip. That's how. That's fucking awesome. That's the best. That's the best. Like, that was all. That's all I wanted to see. Why don't you just do that all the time? I don't know. Like,
this is a good response to the week before.
Yeah,
and when Ascension jacked up Neville.
Hell yeah! Like,
wasn't that Neville?
Was it Neville?
Yeah, it was definitely. I think yeah, because Stardust and Neville were in this.
Yeah, like, they were supposed to have the match, and that's when the Cosmic Wasteland.
Was that like, what was this?
Well, wasn't that on SmackDown?
It was on SmackDown.
Yeah.
Well, it was the Ascension versus the Lucha Dragons, and then Ascension win clean. No, they win, don't win clean. Stardust gets on the apron.
No, this was before that.
To Kalisto. To distract Kalisto, which they destroyed after that, and then they picked the bones, and then that's when Neville ran out for the save.
No, but the Ascension came out and attacked Neville.
Oh, before he came.
And there was also this same match was on Superstars last week too. So just to tie everything.
This non-match?
Oh no, not the non-match. They actually wrestled for like quite a while. It was the main event.
But but yeah, that was a what is it? The face ambush, no match. We find out.
No, because they pulled Stardust out because they dipped after getting your ass beat like that. You gotta leave, man. That's fucking awesome.
But we found out later in the show that we have another match on the Night of Champions card, which is the Lucha Dragons with Neville versus the Cosmic Wasteland. We get a little Nikki Bella.
It's on the pre-show.
Will it be pre-show?
Right, I believe,
probably.
I think that's the pre-show match.
If it happens on Superstars, I'm sure they can't legitimize it to a pay-per-view match.
We get a little Nikki Bella package. I thought was pretty
done real well, I thought. Especially the beginning of it. Like it's like a mock of a motivational speaker kind of a deal into Nikki Bella being a piece of shit. So I thought it worked.
But she's great at.
Yeah, she's real good at it.
You know what she's also good at?
It's almost a shoot or something.
She's really awesome in this match. You know what? This is when moments where I'm just like, ugh. Because we talked about this before. Nikki has improved. Maybe she doesn't look the part. Maybe she doesn't, like, she's not the person that you would like to have, and I think that just plays onto the heel heat of it. She's a doll baby. She's not really grizzled. She's just fake tits, you know, like pretty girl. She dates John Cena. But you know what? It's matches like this when I go like, where did this come from? She's pulling like the most classic of heel performances that I've ever seen.
Well, I mean, they threw all the stops at this match. They had a Flair promo hyping it up. They had this great vignette. And then they kind of held back on the Twin Magic for a while, and then they just busted out. I remember the they've done this before, but like Brie like stuffs her bra with so like that's an added joke. So they did everything they knew would work for this match.
But Nikki's performance, I mean, and you can attest to this, Ombre, because this is one of the reasons why you love Kid and Cesaro. It's one of the reasons why
technical difficulty.
The microphone fell. Mic down. Gotta throw the X on the shit. But sorry about that. I'll probably have that mute because you probably hear it. But she worked the arm the entire match. She got an opening on the arm when she came off the top buckle. And she basically, like, you know, bam, came down on her from the second buckle. I think she was trying to put her up for maybe like a, I don't know, like a belly to belly. I don't know. But she ends up grabbing the arm, coming down on it, and she worked that arm through three fucking segments. They come out of that fucking commercial break. She's still working on the arm. They come out another commercial break. She's still working the arm. Amazing stuff. I was like, you know what, Nikki? You get my respect. You don't get my respect too much. Nikki, I know you're watching the show. You, Ryback, and Roman Reigns. Y'all probably all watching this shit together. I'm just saying.
It's quite the crew.
Kudos to working a good old school style match. Way to keep the heel heat on you. Even a good finish. I dig it. That was a great match to me.
I love the celebration, especially like Team PCB buys it. Flair comes out, and then they show like what happened.
Steph comes out.
Yeah, Steph comes out. It's, you know, kind of breaks the news, I guess, to everybody. But then announces like a little twist to their match at Night of Champions, where right. It doesn't matter how they win. Yeah, it just matters who wins. Which, I mean, maybe with the record already set, maybe we'll get another a new champion.
So that's back to back. I don't think there's been a dusty finish between the last dusty finish that Nikki retained the belt.
Correct.
So she has back-to-back with nobody else doing it, dusty finishes.
I wanted to see her lose.
I wanted
to break AJ Lee's streak, and I guess that's the big deal with that. But I think it would have been a better match if after the false finish there, Charlotte had said, you know, really done something revolutionary. Like,
well,
you're still here and you can still wrestle. I'm still here. Like, let's finish this match. Done that plenty of times.
Stephanie McMahon denied the babyface heat from Charlotte Flair to get on the mic and talk some shit. It's like, if you got any fucking balls, you'll face me at Night of Champions. Okay, you beat your fucking streak, right?
Yeah.
But I'm still going to beat you.
Well,
challenge me. To a rematch at Night of Champions. Cool. But no, Stephanie has to come out and be like,
wins, but you still have the title.
Yeah, like she took away all the heat.
Yeah, she's been doing this, I think, throughout the Divas Revolution. Like, even at the beginning, like, they built it up as Paige's Revolution, but then Stephanie got to announce all the new ones and everything like that. And I just want to say, like, everyone who says, like, it's like a failed Divas Revolution, I mean, look at how, like, we're all talking about it online and everything, like, no one gave a fuck either way what happened to any women's wrestling match on Raw. But now, there's not only two women's wrestling matches on Raw, but now we're all arguing over who should have won the women's title. Like, this is...
No, I'm not arguing over who wins the women's title. I'm pro Nikki over here.
No, I'm saying, that's what I'm saying. Like, we have been discussing it. Like, before, like, I didn't give a fuck who had that
title.
Of course. Like, I didn't care. Like, could have been... It still was on Moolah, for all I was concerned.
But I think it's... You know what this argument is, though? I think it's more or less the wrestling elitists that are against Nikki that make it the conversation than, say, people who are talking about it.
But the women's...
And you, sir!
The women's are mid-card feud, so I would say, like, the wrestling elitists are the only ones that are going to talk about it anyways. What sells the pay-per-views are the John Cena's and the Rocks, mm-hmm. and the Brock Lesnar's and the mm-hmm. Stings. Mm-hmm. So all this mid-card is just for us anyways.
I like the main events too.
I mean, yeah, they're cool, but I'm just saying the revolution is already here. We're watching it. We give a fuck, and that's the revolution.
I give a fuck about one storyline, and that should be for the belt. I still don't agree with all the girls coming up. Hey, you know, make it into sugar. You know, I deal with it, but anything happening other than say the fight for the belt, I don't care. Give them the minutes. Give them the matches. Give them the minutes. But I only want one. That Sasha Banks Paige thing is a waste of my fucking time.
Well, yeah, but wasn't this for the belt right here, though?
That's what I said. Did you just hear me?
With wrestling legend Stephanie McMahon and Ric Flair involved.
Did you just hear me? Give this son bitch kudos?
I think you
were
have
you just
to,
here?
You oh, have to have that second match, though, to it. Develop a match for number one contendership.
No, I don't believe in that number one contendership crap.
Yeah, I think Charlotte's winning, and then.
But then who goes against her? Or other than
they'll find
match.
Something. No,
I think it's they gotta, just yeah they do like they tease the tension with Team PCB and everything and break that all up, and then that's when Sasha comes up and says, "Hey, I've already got my motherfuckers. Like, you're already broken up. I want you, Charlotte. Boom, proven great match. You know, right there." And you can do. She's already tapped out. She's already tapped out. Paige. She's already tapped out. Nikki.
I'm already tapped out.
Yeah, I mean,
Peter's out.
She's even tapping out Peter over here, virtually.
God, no! It's not gonna work that way. It's just not.
What would have been great is if Charlotte had won Monday and then taken that title and dumped it in the trash.
Yeah, like Medusa.
Yes.
Yeah.
Rusev versus Cesaro. We've talked a bunch about that. Goddamn revolution. But we do get a rematch. We find out that there's going to be a rematch at Night of Champions. all losses to Nikki disqualification over the top rope. She even said over the top rope.
That's important, man. Because, well, there's a lot of matches that
is going to King Carino on the side?
I'm just kidding.
But she mentioned that.
It's
like
everything.
Yeah. She said over the top rope, which I thought was pretty funny.
I mean, all encompassing.
Yeah. King Carino, where you at, buddy?
This match was real quick. But Ziggler came out here to distract Rusev and gave Summer Rae a gift. And then through that distraction, I say Rusev did, I would say, the best roll-up ever. Okay.
Nikki Bella's match was better than his fucking roll-up.
No. I'll tell you why. Because all shit, it was impossible to kick out of this roll-up. He fucking tied.
Oh, yeah.
He tied his right arm behind his back.
Yeah.
Put his left arm behind his shoulder. Used his right leg, kicked him over, and then hooked his legs with his legs. So no arms, no legs. It's impossible to tap out. Cesaro's gonna win the world title on this move. It's fucking sick.
That's all he needs is that one roll up.
If he can hit this move, it's like the RKO. You can't kick out of this fucking roll up. It was fucking perfect, dude.
Because my whole thing was when they came out, Cesaro has.
Ruru.
Don't do it. Beiru.
You don't like the Days of Our Lives storyline?
Hey, man. I'm cutting a promo here. Don't cut me off. Shut up. So, what is that? Days of Our Lives? There's a Ruru on Days of Our Lives?
No. Days of Our Lives is a soap opera.
Yeah, but
like,
what?
Like Ziggler and Rusev.
Like the
Ziggler-Rusev
Lana angle.
Oh.
That this whole match centered around.
It gets good. Outside. It gets horrible. It gets good. It gets horrible. It gets good. It gets horrible. He has a win. Cesaro has a win over Rusev.
Oh, yeah.
SmackDown. And they didn't bring it up. Right?
What about Cesaro getting Cena'd a little bit? Like, Cesaro getting cheered so much from the Cesaro section that people started chanting, fuck Cesaro. And then Cesaro got the New Day clap chant.
Cesaro with, section.
Yeah, like, Cesaro. So, I think that shows how much, even though Cesaro didn't get cheered from Triple H saying his name, which probably shows you how little Triple H is over in 2015, but Cesaro is definitely over. He's getting fucking Cena'd in Memphis, Tennessee.
Let's see, I mean, again, I don't know what's going on. Hey, you want your boy to go over, don't cheer for him. You want him to get a push, don't cheer for him. Don't cheer for anybody you like. They're going to get a push. You start cheering for him, you start showing up with little sections, you know, Zack Ryder section. We're getting your ass off TV.
Right in front of the TV this week? Dude,
get your ass off TV.
I think it's nuts.
But I thought, I was like, I was just going like, oh man, Cesaro's going to lose. Again, I mean, I kind of tuned out. And then when Dolph showed up, and then the victory, and it's...
And then the high five.
He shows up with a small package, which the win is a small package.
Oh.
He shows up. Dolph shows up with a small package, which was kind of a, what's the word? Spoiler to how the fucking match will end. So it was a distraction roll-up, small package.
That's perfect.
Y'all didn't mention that?
I didn't catch that at all.
It's funny. I didn't catch it until I think Michael Cole says, oh, no. JBL, because JBL's slick sometimes. Like wore the hat and he threw it in the crowd and he goes, that sure did hit the mark.
Yeah, that's hilarious.
He says, oh, he came out with like this small package. He says it. And I go, perfect. That's perfect.
I missed that one.
Yeah.
JBL does have some
gems. Was slick. It was real slick. But Cesaro gets the win. And I just go like, wow. Okay, so.
What it mattered to you?
On Raw. So this is the fourth time that Cesaro has lost to a pin.
Rusev.
So what'd I say?
Cesaro. Okay. Yeah, backwards.
Cesaro. And Cesaro has two of those pins. I think that's pretty impressive. But
they still don't push him. He's still just lumbering around.
Well, it depends on whatever, but Dolph is an asshole. Dolph is the bad guy. Dolph is the jerk. Dolph is the big jerk. Rusev is the babyface here. I said that last week. This guy's getting jerked around. And Dolph is coming off as an asshole. Not only does he have his old girl, he's walking out giving small packages to his to his new girl.
But I don't think that was for like a gift for her, like, hey, what's up, baby, kind of gift. It was like a mess with Rusev kind of gift.
And then, and like, and plus it showed that, like,
I know, his, but still.
It showed, like, Rusev girl was, like, kind of still on, like, Ziggler, because she kept the package. Yeah, you know? She could have just left it on the table, but they made a big deal that she kept it.
Yeah, she kept
and
it.
And opened it.
Yeah, but after a super kick by Dolph. Like, he's done nothing.
So that's, yeah, so
not he's, only did he get
he's kind of punking Rusev right
he
here.
He fucking ran in after the destruction roll up and just kicked him right in the mouth.
Yeah.
Like, goddamn, Danielson. Johnny ain't doing nothing to you. Johnny's doing nothing to you. You're coming off as a fucking jerk. I am rooting for Rusev. You're the asshole. You're the bully Sheamus right now. You know, fucking Rusev is Mark Henry and Dolph Ziggler is Sheamus. You remember when Mark Henry pulled that fucking tractor trailer?
Oh, yeah.
While Sheamus was the face? And they was just bullying the living shit out of Mark Henry, making his life a living hell. Like, they would have, like, an arm wrestling contest.
And, young Mark Henry in the video game 2016.
Yeah, and Sheamus cheated. It just, like, kept fucking with him. This is the same thing. This is the exact same thing. Mark Henry ended up going over as the babyface in that feud in the end. And this is what's going to happen to Rusev. And I'm finally going to get my Rusev babyface.
What happens to Summer Rae?
Summer Rae joins Dolph.
The thing that bothers me
and then Dolph's
about
got
the,
two ladies?
No,
like
no.
Macho Man?
Lana's...
Yeah.
Lana's watching the show. She sees what's happening.
The thing that bothers me is
I hear that.
It's the lack of storyline. No one was talking that she was just with Miz like 2 months ago.
Oh, yeah.
That during the Marine, that didn't last.
They had Hogan real quick.
Yeah, I got you Hogan know, real like, quick. Because that dealt more with...
She's been around to just about every guy.
Well, that dealt also with...
And then she was with Sandow.
Yeah, Sandow, that's
she
it.
She came
it
out had, with Fandango.
It had more to do with Sandow than anything else.
She's been going
because
around.
She made Sandow, she built up Sandow, and
the booking committee is writing her as, like, you know, a whore. But, like, what can you do? Stop defacing Summer Rae, the booking committee.
She's from Raleigh, man.
Hashtag Summer Rae.
She's from Raleigh. Raleigh's all Carolina, baby.
There you go. A lot of great NC women. Yeah.
So let's.
Charlotte.
Oh, God. What the fuck is Zara from?
Charlotte.
Whiteville?
Charlotte. Area.
Sounds like Whiteville.
Yeah. Charlotte, Summer Rae. This is great.
So let's get to this main event.
Yeah, it started out as Sting and Big Show a la Monday Night Nitro. Because Sting headlined or main evented this Raw, he's the only person who main evented the last Nitro and the last Raw for this whole week. How cool is that? It's fucking sick.
Saturday.
And I thought, like,
Dan Patrick.
I thought they got, like, a little old school. Like, if you watch the way they brawled and even the 10 count and into the choke slam and everything, that was, like, I don't know, you don't really see that kind of, maybe I'm just being weird, but or, like, nostalgic, but, like, you don't really see, like, that style of brawl between them go down anymore. I don't know, like,
of who?
Like, just by anybody. Like, Big Show and Sting, like, they were, like, the way they were kicking and punching to start it off into, like, just... And then the way they built to Big Show's height, playing to advantage of just Sting, like, not necessarily out, like, working him, but, like, out, like, smarting him with just the DDT.
It really did look like a WCW like, match.
It was tied in real well. And then Cena came out. Rollins came out. Cena came out.
Which I thought was awesome because one thing JBL brought up that he actually teamed with the Ultimate Warrior. I don't think that's ever been mentioned.
Oh yes, before Sting and Warrior.
Yeah, they were the Dingo Warriors and they were the Blade Runners.
Yeah, they were the Blade Runners. I think it was like Sting and Flash.
And the Dingo Warriors. And I'm like, I don't think that's ever been mentioned.
No. Ultimate Warrior was the Dingo Warrior before he was the Ultimate Warrior, but he wasn't the Dingo Warrior. But when Sting and
when they were tag team, that was one of their names. That was their name. The Dingo Warrior. I remember watching.
I don't know. I don't think.
No, I remember watching.
They started out as a Road Warriors ripoff, and they were the Blade Runners.
Yeah, but I think before that, when they were super swole, like super duper swole, and I remember them running Blackjack Mulligan and another dude because they were just like
Blackjack Lanza, the original Blackjack.
It was somebody, but like they showed up. These old fat dudes just roll up on them. It's like y'all think y'all some hot shit. It was like a straight shoot. They took him in the ring, beat the living shit out of both of them. And they went by, I remember, this is like an old clip I saw on YouTube, and they went by the Dingo Warriors.
I have to look that up.
That's interesting. Yeah. I knew that, yeah, they were the Blade Runners too, yeah, and I knew they teamed and everything, and then they broke up, and then like you saw clips throughout the night where like Ultimate Warrior went to WWE and Sting went to WCW, and they both just tried to like make whatever they can out of both of them. Mm-hmm. So that was, yeah.
They showed the one clip of...
Would you consider them the best tag team? The best tag team split of all time? The greatest? I mean, one became Sting, the other one became the Ultimate Warrior. You don't get that too much out of tag teams. Yeah. That one guy leaves, and then other guy's Jannetty.
So yeah, the other guy's Jannetty, they have to be a team before they split? That, or it can't just be two guys that are teamed.
They came
and then split. Like,
well, just we're a tag team.
Like
all
the
together.
Mega Powers.
Well, like they came in as a tag team.
Okay, right.
They came together as a tag.
Yeah, team. I mean, I think. I mean, I'd have to think about it a little more, but I definitely think
Edge and
for
Christian.
Sure. There's always that Jannetty. There's always that that Matt Hardy, the Rick Steiner. You know?
Because Christian and him having like pretty much a successful career, but not as much as.
Yeah, I mean, he had like the TNA title, Gibson. The SmackDown title.
He had the world title for 2 days, but he got it.
The Robert Gibson, yeah.
The Robert Gibson. But did. Wait a minute. Did. Robert Gibson, who was the.
Robert Gibson.
Oh, Ricky Morton. Ricky Morton.
Rock and Roll Express, man.
Did Morton have a, because I was thinking Beautiful Bobby, but
Morton was the one that
Morton was just over, dude.
Yeah, he'd like, what is that, Jim Ross and Jim Cornette are always talking about throwing babies in the air.
Still worse to this day.
But he never had
it. Still worse to this day. His kid's got the same mullet. If you go to the indie shows, his kid's like young as fuck. Still, I don't know, like that's post 9/11 kids still rocking the mullet. It's fucking nuts. Like it's fucking ridiculous.
He has Mullet Club t-shirts.
Oh, yeah. I did see the Mullet Club t-shirt.
Yeah.
But Edge and Christian probably come second. That's it. I mean,
well, yeah, second, like a far away second.
Far away.
Ultimate Warrior and Sting.
I know.
I mean,
they became icons. They became icons.
Yeah.
Well, anyway,
that's nuts to think about.
So let's get through this so we can get to the.
Yeah, Big Show gets real blown up if you watch. I thought it was funny. Like Rollins is like, "You want to tag out? Nope, you got it, buddy." And then like Rollins just like tags himself in after like a move, so you can tell like. Rollins didn't want to maybe admit to the older dude that he was a little blown out, but he could kind of see, and I saw it most definitely, like red face, sweating everywhere. He needed to take a little break. Rollins does a few moves, tags him back in, and then they go for this big finish, hot tag for Sting.
Mm-hmm. Hot tag!
Yeah, Sting goes nuts.
From 8 feet across the...
Yeah, the big diving hot
tag.
He's
been beat for like the last 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden he can jump 8 feet across the...
Well, he's been
Cena power.
Well, he's been chilling.
Well, that's the hustle part of the hustle loyalty.
Oh, okay.
Respect, are they?
Right. Respect.
Yeah.
And then the loyalty did anyone else? Right did there. Anyone else think it was weird that? But yeah, what happened? Like he put him in the dead drop. I mean, the death drop.
Oh, I saw what happened. Yeah, AA to Big Show, and then Rollins comes in trying to get his little snarky ass involved.
Pedigree.
Right. With a pedigree, but then Scorpion Death Drop, Scorpion Deathlock, Sting looking fucking smooth as ever.
He taps out so upset.
Like a little bitch. Sting's winning the title.
Sting's not winning the title. did anyone find it weird that Seth ran out with the belt?
Yeah, because that's the last time he's going to hold those two belts because Sting's winning this fucking
title. Like, that was weird, though, to me.
He might be on SmackDown.
Did he have to have both belts in his hand as he runs down to fucking get the sneak attack in? Like, couldn't he just left
it? Well, I think that the reason why they didn't just leave it Sting and Big Show is because they were like, okay, this is going to get all the people that maybe don't like football but are still, we're fans in the Attitude Era. But how can we get them to stay around till maybe Night of the Champions? How can we get them to stay around for maybe next Raw? We have to showcase Rollins. We have to showcase Cena to
the
make
the new and the old.
Yeah, the new and the old. They have to have Cena out there to bridge the gap. They have to have Rollins out there with the belts. They have to whoever's happens to stumble across this from the Attitude Era has to at least stay with us. So then that's why they made it a tag match, and they booked it kind of like an Attitude Era match would be booked. I thought it was perfect.
When I saw there was 17 minutes left, I was like, no way in hell is this going to last 17 minutes just the two of them. That was my sleuthing.
None of that slow pace.
That was my sleuthing. My sleuthing.
I was marking out, man. I was like, what the fuck is going on? I don't know. I was stoked.
Yeah,
I was
stoked. Mr. Sting. You're still a Triple H guy, by the way. I still owe you that shirt. I forgot. This ain't SmackDown, where people forget shit go down. This ain't WWE. Well, hey, remember that time when you bet it that you would never watch Monday Night Raw again if Sting loses to Triple H?
For a year.
Okay.
But I mean, NWO came out, man. If NWO is coming out to help Sting, that's bullshit. Beep, like that can't happen. It needed to be Lex Luger and God bless Flying Brian Pillman's soul. Maybe he could come out. Like maybe it could have been like we could have had some great WWE faces, but we didn't. We didn't have it. We had NWO, which NWO has historically been against Sting.
If Jericho would have ran out, whose side would he have been on anyway? Whose side would he have been on?
I'm not sure.
He probably...
Definitely not Triple H.
But he became Raw.
Yeah, he became Raw, but he was against...
No, Raw became Jericho!
He won his titles against Triple H, like Mania and the Hell in the Cell versus Stephanie and everything.
He wouldn't have came out...
I'd say he just wouldn't come out at all.
Okay. I'm just saying if he would have ran out. Bring the walls down! That would have been great. He still has the greatest intros. So, yeah, all right, so that's it.
Yeah, Sting stands tall at the end, which, I mean, yeah, all joking aside, I do think that probably shows Rollins is probably going to look pretty strong at the Night of Champions.
Hope not.
I mean, in my head, I already know. Like, no way in hell Sting's going to hold that belt.
Oh, dude, if he wins, though, just
a
day.
And I still feel like...
Just a moment. What if it's a cash-in?
I think there's two records to be beat. One is AJ Lee, mission accomplished. Second one, CM Punk. Let's get him down. Let's knock him down a notch. Even though Seth is a shitty champion, this is the petty nonsense crap that we deal with when dealing with the WWE. And I don't see Seth dropping that belt to nobody. Nobody. Even after WrestleMania.
It's going
to
be a
even though the WWE World Heavyweight Championship belt will be the first match on WrestleMania, Seth Rollins is keeping that belt. You betcha. So... How does someone find you on the old Twitters?
I don't have a Twitter.
You don't have a Twitter? Good. No. You. So there's no way to find you online.
I don't know how to tweet. I got a Facebook. That's about it.
How does someone find you on your Facebook?
You just look my name up, Luke Williams.
Luke Williams.
Or you can check out the band that I do.
Oh, yeah, I do.
Born Hollow. We're on Facebook, Bandcamp, bornhollow.bandcamp.com.
Born Hollow?
You have any like shows or anything coming out?
We're playing with Norma Jean at Green Street next Wednesday, so a week from today.
That's Green Street in Greensboro, North Carolina. Hell yeah, that's pretty big.
Born Hollow. Born Hollow and Bandcamp.
Yep, bandcamp.com.
So check his shit out, man.
Facebook, Instagram.
Norma Jean, you know who Norma Jean is? Norma Jean is like the second band from Chic.
What?
You know Chic? Good times. We are the good times.
I know that song, yeah.
Yeah, that's Chic. When they came back, they broke up, they came back as Norma Jean.
Yeah, they got heavy as fuck.
No, they didn't. They got funky.
This Norma Jean.
And then Norma Jean became Changes. And then Changes became just Luther Vandross.
Okay.
God, I was like, I need to go. I ought to go crash that party.
If you believe that, you can come out to Green Street on
September 23rd.
Fuck yeah, there you go. Like next
Wednesday.
We're going after this. No, you gotta watch.
Well, we're gonna go record the podcast that day, and then we're gonna go to Norma Jean.
Speaking of podcasts, so again, Born Hollow, check his ass out over there. We got Fascinated World Podcast.
Fascinated World Podcast. Listen to me at soundcloud.com/JGProWrestling. Talk to me at twitter.com/JGProWrestling. I'm on Mark Charles's radio show slash podcast every Thursday, Outside Interference. And I'm going to probably bring a new podcast that I've been working on. The Superstars of Superstars. I'm going to review Superstars every Saturday morning.
Did you just freestyle that name right then? He was telling me about this podcast like... earlier, before we even recorded, he couldn't even come up with a name. He just came up with a name right then.
No, it's the Superstars of Superstars. So I'm gonna pick
straight shoot.
I'm going to pick one superstar to hold the Superstars title every week, and if you impress me, you win the Superstars title. You win the Superstars Superstars every week.
Ain't that some shit.
This week it goes, I'm going to give it to Kalisto this week. So Kalisto holds the title. Tune in to find out if he retains.
So Kalisto is the longest running Superstars champion.
Yeah, minute to minute.
Until
it's the Kalisto clock.
It's the Kalistotron. PJTW Central, that's how you find my ass on Twitter. Hit the button below. Subscribe to the Peter and Jake Talks Wrestling YouTube page. Also, we're on iTunes. We're also, subscribe to that shit. Add that shit to your favorites list. Also, on Stitcher Radio, just type Peter and Jake Talks Wrasslin. That's Wrasslin. Slin. Slin. Wrasslin. Apostrophe. And also on, just type up Peter and Jake Talks Wrasslin on the SoundCloud. Again, like, subscribe, comment, share. Sharing is caring. And without further ado, that's part one of Peter and Jake Talks Rat. Peter, Jake, and Luke Talks Wrasslin, episode 56. That's part one. Part two will be up tomorrow, which will be our predictions, which when you see, we're going to be wearing the same clothes because we're just going to record this shit right after we're done with this, and then it will be uploaded to the interwebs.
Everywhere all at once.
Yes, tomorrow. So again, tonight, Peter, Jake, and Luke Talks Wrasslin 56. Tomorrow, part two. I'm about to say SummerSlam. Night of Champions.
Hell in a Cell.
Halloween Havoc. prediction show. So, we'll see you tomorrow. Peace, bitches.